Hey there, welcome back to my channel.
Today's topic is cerebellum, and cerebellum we all know is quite a complicated topic, but I am here to make this topic very, very easy for you people. Don't by heart cerebellum, try and understand the concept behind the cerebellum, and things will fall in place and things are going to become very easy for you to understand. And once you understand the concept, then it is going to become very, very easy for you to write in your examination. So without wasting much time, let's start with the cerebellum. And for those people who have not subscribed to my channel, please hit the bell icon as well as hit the subscribe button. Okay, so let's first define the learning objectives as to under what subheadings are we going to learn cerebellum. Let's have a brief introduction with the cerebellum, and let's see what are the functional divisions of the cerebellum, how cerebellum is organized into outer cortex and inner nuclear layer. And then very important point is the connections. So I say you stay, you watch the video at least till the connections, because that's the most important and the confusing part. And at last we will see the functions. And in this video, I have not included the cerebellar lesions, like what the patient presents with whenever there is cerebellar lesions and what are the tests we do to find out the cerebellar lesion. I'll make a separate short video for that. In this video, we will confine ourselves to these many learning objectives. So let's start with the introduction part. So here we are seeing this is where cerebellum is located. So if anybody asks you where cerebellum is located, it's very easy, under the cerebrum. And the cerebellum is separated from the cerebrum by a fold of dura mater. Okay. Most interesting part, if we compare cerebrum with the cerebellum, that we have to understand here is that the weight of the cerebellum is only 10% of the weight of the cerebrum. Okay, but the surface area of the cerebellum is 75% of the cerebrum. That means the surface area is extremely more compared with that of the cerebrum. That means the foldings are more. Second very important point that we should understand here is that cerebellum is extensively connected to the brain stem. Okay, it is having connections with the midbrain, it is having connections with the pons, and it is also having connections with the medulla oblongata. Now, how is it that cerebellum is connected to the midbrain? Is that via superior peduncle. Okay, there are peduncles, these are the connections. How is it that cerebellum is connected to the pons via the middle peduncle, and cerebellum is connected to the medulla oblongata via the inferior peduncle? Okay. Next point that we should understand here is that, see, this is the diagram of the cerebellum. Cerebellum, like the cerebral hemisphere, is having two portions. This is one cerebellar hemisphere and this is another cerebellar hemisphere. And both these cerebellar hemispheres are connected together. You are seeing here this worm-like structure which is in between. This is what is called as vermis. Because it is worm-like structure, that's why it is called as vermis. So we have two cerebellar hemispheres, and these two cerebellar hemispheres are connected by a worm-like structure, which is called as vermis. Moving ahead, anatomically, the cerebellum is divided into three lobes. So what are those three lobes? Yes, we have what is called as the anterior lobe, this one. Okay, one, this is anterior lobe. This entire thing is called as the posterior lobe, and this small portion what you are seeing here extending here in this area, this is what is called as the floculonodular lobe. And these three divisions are based on the fissures. There are two fissures which are dividing the cerebellum into three divisions. So what is the first fissure? The first fissure is what is called as primary fissure. So this one, okay, so this is the one which divides the cerebellum into anterior and the posterior lobe. And then we have one more fissure which is called as posterolateral fissure, which is dividing the cerebellum into a posterior lobe and then this lobe which is called as a floculonodular lobe. Okay, this small portion here adjacent to the vermis, this is called as flocculus. Okay, this is called as flocculus. Okay, these are called as nodules. Okay, so that's why this lobe is becoming floculonodular lobe. Okay, this much is more than enough with regards to the introduction. Next, let's go to the functional division. See, anatomical divisions, just now what I told you were the anatomical divisions. Anatomical divisions are entirely different from that of the functional divisions. Okay, but only one thing is similar, that is the flocculonodular lobe. This lobe, which we had seen, that is now we are calling it as vestibulocerebellum. Okay, the flocculonodular lobe is referred to as vestibulocerebellum. Now, why it is called as vestibulocerebellum? Because this part of the cerebellum has extensive connections with the vestibular apparatus and the vestibular nuclei. And this part of the cerebellum is concerned with maintenance of the balance and also the eye movement. So, there is a reflex here which is called as vestibulo-ocular reflex. Just remember this thing. So the vestibulocerebellum is concerned with maintenance of balance, and it is also concerned with the functioning of a reflex which is called as vestibulo-ocular reflex. Now let's enter into the main part of the cerebellum. Okay, so here this portion, what we are seeing here, this much, this is called as a vermis. And this portion, what we are seeing here, this is called as the paravermis. Paravermis is nothing but the adjoining portion of the vermis. So, the vermis and the paravermal portion, which are present on either side of the vermis, these together, they are called as spinocerebellum. These together, they are called as spinocerebellum. And what is the main function of the spinocerebellum? Why are we calling it as spinocerebellum? It's because spinocerebellum is receiving the proprioceptive impulses from the spinal cord. One thing is that. Okay, it is receiving the proprioceptive impulses from the spinal cord. Spinocerebellum is also receiving a copy of the motor action which is coming from the cerebral cortex. Okay, it is just receiving a copy. Now, the cerebral cortex says, I want to execute this particular motion or this particular movement. A copy of that is sent to the spinocerebellum. Okay, now the spinocerebellum is getting two information. One is it is getting the sensory information, and it is also getting the motor information from the motor cortex. And then what is the ultimate function of the spinocerebellum? The fibers from the spinocerebellum, they are going to cause what is called as motor execution. How? Like the cerebral cortex tells that I want to carry out this particular movement. Now, it is the spinocerebellum which is going to cause this movement in a nice way. Okay, that is called as coordinated and smoothened way of movement, or else the movement is going to become very much haphazard and jerky. Okay, now one more important point that we have to remember here is that the fibers which are there in the vermis of the spinocerebellum, they are the one which are descending to the medial descending systems, and we all know that the medial descending system is the one which is concerned with the maintenance of posture. Okay, because these medial descending systems are the one which are supplying to the axial group of muscles. And then the fibers which are present in the paravermal portion of the spinocerebellum, they are the one which are descending to the lateral descending systems, and lateral descending systems are the one which are concerned with the fine motor movements. Fine motor movements. So these are the functions of the spinocerebellum. Now remaining part of the cerebellum, that is what is called as neocerebellum, or it is also called as cerebrocerebellum. Okay, neocerebellum or the cerebrocerebellum. Why it is called as cerebrocerebellum? Because it is having connections with the cerebral cortex. That is, it is having connections with the motor as well as the premotor cortices. So, what is the function of the neocerebellum? Neocerebellum is the one which is helping in the motor planning. Very, very important to understand these three things. And it is said that vestibulocerebellum is phylogenetically the oldest part, and neocerebellum is phylogenetically the newest part. Okay, you can also write down these points. First was I told regarding vestibulocerebellum. What was vestibulocerebellum? It was nothing but the flocculonodular lobe. Okay, fine. Second thing regarding vestibulocerebellum is that phylogenetically it is the oldest part. Third thing is, what is the main function of vestibulocerebellum? Vestibulocerebellum is concerned with equilibrium and balance, to this, you can also add, it is also concerned with the functioning of a reflex, which is called as vestibulo-ocular reflex. Equilibrium, balance, and vestibulo-ocular reflex. Okay, that's what I am telling. Now, coming to the spinocerebellum. So, what is spinocerebellum? Spinocerebellum is the vermis, but plus the adjacent part of the vermis, which is called as the paravermis. Just now I explained. What does spinocerebellum do? It receives the proprioceptive input from the body. Then it also receives a copy of motor plan from the motor cortex. Two important things it is doing. It is taking the information, proprioceptive information from the body. It is also receiving a copy of the motor plan from the motor cortex. And what does it ultimately do? It compares the plan with the performance. I have planned in this way. In this way, is the body performing in the same way or not? Okay, and if the body is not performing in the same way as the motor cortex has planned, that point of time cerebellum is going to intervene in between, and it is going to make that movement in a smooth and coordinated manner. That is the function of spine, cerebellum. Simple, very simple. Vestibulo with the balance, equilibrium, vestibulo-ocular reflex, and spinocerebellum, because it is receiving information from the proprioceptive information also it is receiving. It is receiving a copy of the motor plan from the motor cortex, and ultimately what it is doing, it is comparing the plan with the performance. So, it is helping in smoothening and coordination of the movements. Next, we have neocerebellum. What is neocerebellum? The remaining part of the cerebellar hemisphere is what is called as neocerebellum, and it is also called as cerebrocerebellum. This lateral portion which is remaining in the cerebellum, it is the nearest part phylogenetically, and it is interacting with the motor cortex. And what is its main function? Its main function is planning and programming of the movements. And one more structure whose function was planning and programming of the movements was basal ganglia. Okay, so this is regarding the functional divisions of the cerebellum. Next, let's see very important concept to understand either in anatomy or in physiology is the organization of the cerebellum. Now, cerebellum is broadly divided into two portions. One is an outer portion. The outer portion is called as cortex. Another one is an inner portion. And the inner part is the one which is containing deep cerebellar nucleus. The outer portion may cortex, inner portion may we are having deep cerebellar nuclei. So now let's see how does a cortex looks like. Okay, cortex may there are basically three layers. What are those three layers? First layer is what is called as the molecular layer. Okay, second layer is called as Purkinje cell layer, and the third layer is called as granule cell layer. Clear? Three layers: molecular, Purkinje cell, granule cell. In the molecular layer, we are having two cells. We are having two cells. What are those two cells? First cell is what is called as basket cell. Okay. And the second cell is what is called as stellate cell. Okay. This is regarding the molecular layer. Next, coming to the Purkinje cell layer. Purkinje cell layer is having only one cell. And what is the name of the cell? As the layer name itself is Purkinje cell layer, so the cell which is present here is Purkinje cell. Remember, Purkinje cell is one of the largest neurons which is present in the central nervous system. Okay? And this Purkinje cell is the only output from the cerebellum. It is the only output. Output from the Purkinje cell is going into the deep cerebellar nuclei, and Purkinje cell is the only output. One more important point that we should understand regarding Purkinje cell is that Purkinje cell is not limiting itself to the Purkinje cell layer. This Purkinje cell is sending dendrites. These are called as arbors or dendrites. As here you can see, see this is the Purkinje cell. Here you can see the dendrites of the Purkinje cells, and where are these dendrites entering? These dendrites are entering in the molecular layer. Okay, and they are extensively synapsing with both the stellate cell as well as the basket cell. Stellate cell as well as the basket cell, and the axon of the Purkinje cell is going deep down. and it is going down and it is communicating with the deep cerebellar nuclei. I hope I am clear. This is regarding the Purkinje cell layer and the Purkinje cell. Third important layer is what is called as granule cell layer. Again, in the granule cell layer, we are having two cells. Okay, one is called as Golgi cell, here you can see, and the second cell is called as the granule cell. Here you can see that cell. Okay, even the granule cell is not keeping quiet. What is happening to the axon of the granule cell is that the granule cell's axon is going to enter again into the molecular layer, and once it has entered into the molecular layer, it is bifurcating. Okay, what it is doing, it is bifurcating in the form of T like this. So the axon is going to enter into the molecular layer, and once it has entered into the molecular layer, it is bifurcating. And these bifurcated axons, these are running a very long distance in the molecular layer, and they are running parallel to the other layers. Hence, these axons are called as parallel fibers. Okay, all these things we are going to use in the connection. So remember these things. Very easy. Molecular layer is having two cells, the basket cell and the stellate cell. Purkinje cell layer is having only one cell, that is the Purkinje cell. The dendrites of the Purkinje cell are having extensive connections in the molecular cell layer with both basket cell as well as the stellate cell. And then we are having the third layer, which is called as the granule cell layer. The granule cell layer is having two cells. One is a Golgi cell, another one is a granule cell. The axons of the granule cells are entering into the molecular layer. There they are bifurcating in the form of T-shaped neurons, and these neurons are long. Okay, they are long neurons and they are parallel neurons. And these axons are the one which are called as parallel fibers. So this is regarding the cerebellar cortex. Three layers and five cells. Next, let's go to the deep nuclei. Okay, in the deeper part of the cerebellum, there are four nuclei. We can easily remember them by words D, E, F, G. This is how you remember the deep nuclei. D, E, F, and G. D stands for dentate nucleus. E stands for emboliform nuclei. F stands for epiphyseal nuclei. And G stands for globose nuclei. So these are the four nuclei, but we have to remember that emboliform nucleus and the globose nucleus in combination, they are called as nucleus interpositus. Nucleus interpositus. Fine. This is regarding the deep cerebellar nuclei. So I will give you an overview of what is happening in the cerebellum. Okay, the cerebellar cortex is receiving afferent information. Afferent information, and some processing is happening within the cerebellar cortex. After that, the efferent information from the cerebellar cortex is going out via the Purkinje cell. So that means the Purkinje cell is the only cell which is carrying the output from the cerebellum. Cerebellum has received an input. Something is cooking within the cerebellum. After it has cooked in the cerebellum, the output is going via the Purkinje cell. And where is this output going? The output is going to the deep cerebellar nuclei. From the deep cerebellar nuclei, where does it go? From the deep cerebellar nuclei, it goes to the brainstem nuclei. And from the brainstem nuclei, ultimately it comes down to the spinal cord. What we have in the spinal cord? We have two systems in the spinal cord. One is called as a lateral system, another one is called as the medial system. The medial system is the one which is concerned with posture. The lateral system is the one which is concerned with fine voluntary movements. As simple as that. So this is the overview of what is happening in the cerebellum. Now let's enter and dig deeper and see actually as to what is happening. So that is the part with respect to the connections. So in the connections, we should understand that inputs are there, internal connections are there, that khichdi which is cooking inside the cerebellum, that is called as the internal connections. And after it has cooked, it has to be sent out. Where it has to be sent out? It has to go out to the deep cerebellar nuclei. From there, it has to go to the brainstem nuclei. From the brainstem nuclei, ultimately, it has to go to the spinal cord, and the information from there has to ultimately pass to the muscle. This is what is happening. So let's see the cerebellar input. First input is the spinocerebellar tract, and we all know that there are two spinocerebellar tracts, the dorsal and the ventral. Next is the vestibulocerebellar tract. I have told you that the vestibulocerebellum is the one which is having extensive connections with the vestibular nuclei and the vestibular apparatus. So we also have the vestibulocerebellar tract. Then we have the cuneocerebellar tract, which is carrying the proprioceptive impulses from the head and the neck. Then we have the oleocerebellar tract, which is carrying the proprioceptive information from the entire body. Then we have the tectocerebellar tract. This tectocerebellar tract is the one which is carrying information via superior and the inferior colliculus of the midbrain. And what kind of an information it is carrying? It is carrying visual and auditory information. So this is called as the tectocerebellar tract. And then we have the corticopontocerebellar tract. So this is the information which is coming from the cortex. And where do you think this information is going to? Which part of the cerebellum? Of course, it is going to the cerebrocerebellum, but it is coming via the pons. That's why I'm calling it as corticopontocerebellar. And then at last we have the reticulocerebellar tract. Okay, so these are all the inputs that we have to remember. It's very easy. We all know regarding the spinocerebellar tract. So two are there, dorsal and ventral. We know there is a vestibulocerebellum, so that's why that is receiving the information from the vestibulocerebellar tract. Apart from that, of course, we have to remember these things: cuneocerebellar, oleocerebellar, tectocerebellar, corticopontocerebellar, and reticulocerebellar. So these are the inputs. Okay, how these inputs are coming into the cerebellum? Okay, all these are the inputs. It's not like all these inputs are coming via their own fibers. No, cerebellum is not going to allow the inputs to come into them in that way. Cerebellum is only allowing the inputs majoritily via two fibers. Majoritily via two fibers. So what are they? I will tell you. One is called as the climbing fiber input. So this climbing fiber input is conveying the inputs only from the inferior olivary nucleus, that is from the olivocerebellar tract. So that means among all those inputs which I had listed you there, only the olivocerebellar tract is very special for the cerebellum. So input from the oleocerebellar tract is carried only by one fiber, and that is the climbing fiber. Okay, so what kind of an input is coming? This is a proprioceptive input from the whole body. And where do these climbing fibers project to in the cerebellum? They are projecting to the Purkinje cells. Clear. Next, we will see the second kind of an important input, which is called as a MOSI fiber input. Okay, MOSI fiber input is relaying inputs from the all the remaining tracts. So only one tract, special tract, which was that tract? Olivocerebellar tract carried the information from the olivocerebellar tract, relayed the information to the cerebellum via the climbing fibers, whereas the MOSI fiber is the one which is carrying the information from the remaining all tracts. Okay, so this is a major source of input, and where do these MOSI fibers project to? It is projecting to the granule. Main projection is to the granule cell. Okay, what are the other minor inputs? We have monoaminergic inputs, which is coming from the nucleus raphe magnus and locus coeruleus, and we also have inputs coming from the thalamus. All of them, they are projecting to the deep cerebellar nucleus. So basically speaking, there are so many tracts, all these are called as inputs, and these tracts are projected to the cerebellum via two fibers. One is a climbing fiber, Another one is a mossy fiber. Climbing fiber is carrying the information from only one tract, that is the oleocerebellar tract, whereas mossy fiber is carrying information from the remaining all the tracts. That's clear. That's regarding the input. Now let's see this khichdi which is going on in the cerebellum, which is called as the internal connection. Okay, concentrate on this diagram as I speak. So I told you, so what is all this? This is the cortex of the cerebellum. Okay, and we have all the cells. We have the granule cell, we have the Golgi cell, we have the basket cell, and we have the largest cell, which is the Purkinje's. Fine. And then inputs. What were the two inputs which I had told you? One is climbing fiber, another is mossy fiber. Climbing fiber's main input is going where? It is going to the Purkinje cell. And what is the type of input? Excitatory input. Second input is coming from the mossy fiber. And what is the type of input? Excitatory input. To where it is going? It is going to the granule cell. On the way, they also give input to the deep cerebellar nucleus, and again this input is also excitatory inputs. And I told you, we just don't have inputs coming from the climbing fibers and the mossy fibers. There are some other inputs also. Even these other inputs are also excitatory, and these inputs are going to the deep cerebellar nucleus. Now, the mossy fiber input, which is excitatory, is going to the granule cell. What did I tell regarding the granule cell is that the granule cell is having these axons, and these axons are going to bifurcate in a T-shaped manner, and these fibers are called as the parallel fibers. So this granule cell is having connection with the basket cell, it is having connection with the Golgi cell, it is also having connection with the Purkinje cell. So the granule cell in turn is going to stimulate the basket cell, it stimulates the Golgi cell, and it also stimulates the Purkinje cell. Okay, now granule cell has stimulated the basket cell. Okay, granule cell was stimulated by mossy fiber. Now what the basket cell is doing to the Purkinje cell? It is causing inhibition. So mossy fiber stimulates the granule cell, okay, granule cell stimulates the basket cell, and the basket cell in turn is inhibiting the Purkinje cell. Such a kind of inhibition is called as feed forward inhibition. Okay, it is called as feed forward inhibition. And one more thing that we can see is that the granule cell stimulates the Golgi cell, and what does the Golgi cell do? Golgi cell is again inhibiting the granule cell. Okay, so that means this granule cell and basket cells, these are acting like interneurons. Fine, that's clear. One more second important thing is that, so the Purkinje cell has received an excitatory input from the granule cell. Purkinje cell has also received an excitatory input from the climbing fiber. But what is the output from the Purkinje cell to the deep cerebellar nucleus? That is inhibitory. But the point to remember here is that even though the output of the Purkinje cell to the deep cerebellar nuclei is inhibitory, the deep cerebellar nuclei's output to the brainstem nuclei is always excitatory. So you might be asking me as to, sir, the input is also excitatory and the output is also excitatory. All these things are happening within the cerebellum. What is the ultimate output? Cerebellum is not here to inhibit the input. Cerebellum is here to what is called as modulate the input. Very important word is this. So what does the cerebellum does is, cerebellum helps in modulation of the input. It is not going to inhibit the input. A motor plan has already been sent to the cerebellum. Cerebellum also knows the proprioceptive impulses, Now it's the work of the cerebellum to coordinate and smoothen the movement, not to dampen the movement. Okay, got this? So this is the internal connection which you need to know. And you also have to write regarding what is the meaning of feed forward inhibition. Now from the internal connections, let's move to the output. Okay, and let's divide these outputs into three parts. What is the output coming from the vestibulocerebellum? What is the output coming from the spinocerebellum? And what is the output which is coming from the cerebrocerebellum? So the vestibulocerebellum is one part of the cerebellum which is not projecting to the deep cerebellar nuclei. In fact, the vestibulocerebellum is projecting directly to the vestibular nucleus which is present in the brainstem. Now, okay, how is this projection coming? This projection is coming via the inferior cerebellar peduncle. Now, the vestibular nucleus is projecting via two tracts. One is called as a lateral vestibulospinal tract, and another one is called as the medial vestibulospinal cord, spinal tract to the medial group of alpha motor neurons. Very interesting and very important point I am telling you. So you will have to understand the medial group and the lateral group. The medial group of the alpha motor neurons is basically concerned with the maintenance of posture and balance. And the lateral group of the alpha motor neurons are the ones which are basically concerned with fine motor movements or fine voluntary motor movements. So if the vestibulocerebellum, the output is projecting to the alpha motor neurons which belong to the medial group, that means it is basically concerned with maintenance of posture. This is the output coming from the vestibulocerebellum. Next, let's see the output coming from the vermis part of the spinocerebellum. The vermis is projecting to fastigial nucleus of the deep nuclei. Then this fastigial nucleus can project to two brainstem nucleus. One is the vestibular nucleus, and again the vestibular nucleus is projecting to the alpha motor neurons belonging to the medial group, again concerned with the maintenance of posture. Whereas fastigial nucleus will also project to one more brainstem nuclei, which is called as reticular nucleus. And this reticular nucleus via the reticulospinal tract is projecting to the gamma motor neurons, a very, very important point. Reticular nucleus via the reticulospinal tract is projecting to the gamma motor neurons. Now, can you tell me what is the most important function of the gamma motor neurons? The most important function of the gamma motor neurons is maintenance of muscle tone. Okay, so if this influence is lost, then it results in hypotonia. Okay, it results in hypotonia. Usually there is no paralysis in cerebellar lesions, but there is a slight reduction of the tone that is happening because of this very important tract. Got it? Okay, so this is from the vermis. Now let's see what's happening to the paravermis. The paravermis is projecting to the nucleus interpositors. From the nucleus interpositors, the fibers go to the red nuclei of the brainstem. From there is a rubrospinal tract arising, and this rubrospinal tract is projecting to the lateral group of the alpha motor neuron. So if I say it's the lateral group, that means it is concerned with fine voluntary motor movements. Okay, so that means it is concerned with fine voluntary motor movements. So we have seen the outputs coming from the vestibulocerebellum. We have seen the outputs coming from the spinocerebellum. In the spinocerebellum, the vermis portion of the spinocerebellar outputs are different. The paravermis portion of the spinocerebellar outputs are different. Now let's see the connections of what is called as a neocerebellum or cerebrocerebellum. So where is the cerebral cortex? The cerebral cortex is here, coming from area number 4 and 6. Fine. Then this cerebral cortex, okay, it has to project to the dentate nucleus of the cerebellum, and this is occurring via the pontine nucleus. So we have corticopontine fibers and we also have pontocerebellar fibers. So when we combine all of them, we can write it as corticopontocerebellar fibers. Corticopontocerebellar fibers. Now, again from the dentate nucleus of the cerebellum, these fibers project to the red nucleus. So these are called as dentatorubral fibers, and from the red nucleus via the rubrothalamic fibers, they enter into the thalamus, and from the thalamus they project back to the cortex, and these are called as the thalamocortical fibers. This is how the cerebrocerebellum part is connected to the cerebral cortex, and this is where we end the connections of the cerebellum. So now coming to the functions of the cerebellum. We know it controls equilibrium and postural movement, basically the vestibulocerebellum. It is also concerned with the functioning of the vestibulo-ocular reflex. It helps in smoothening and coordinating the movement. It helps in also controlling of the skilled voluntary movements. I told you the role of the gamma motor, the role of the alpha motor neurons in the lateral part. What does it help in the skilled voluntary movements? It helps to control the rate of the movement, the range of the movement, the force of the movement, the direction of the movement, and the termination of the movement. Rate, range, force, direction, and termination. Okay. Then it also helps in prevention of overshoot, and it damps the movement. When I want to go and pick up something, my hand shouldn't overshoot that particular object. My hand should stop where that object is there. That is what is the meaning of prevention of overshoot and dampening the movement. It helps in control of the ballistic movement. Sometimes maybe I am doing very rapid movement. You would have done in your clinical physiology lab what is called as didechokinesia, wherein a person is asked to rapidly to and fro make the supination and pronation. So it helps in controlling of those ballistic movements. It helps in planning and programming of the movements along with the basal ganglia. It helps also in the maintenance of the tone because of its action on the gamma motor neurons. Okay, so these are all some of the functions of the cerebellum. Okay, hope you have understood this. Just to give you a gist of what happened in this class. So we started with introduction. Okay, then we saw in the introduction what is called as the anatomical divisions. Okay, then we saw what is called as physiological divisions. Okay, basically three divisions: the vestibulocerebellum, the spinocerebellum, and the cerebrocerebellum. Then, very importantly, we also discussed the role of these individual parts in their functioning and to which areas do they project. And then we saw the connections of the cerebellum, wherein we discussed the inputs. We discussed what happens within the cerebellum, okay, within the cerebellum, and then we discussed the outputs. Plus, we also finished the functions of the cerebellum. Fine. I'm not going to do the cerebellar lesions and the cerebellar function test. I will make it a separate video. I hope you have understood, and it's going to become very, very easy for you to write the cerebellum in the examinations. Okay, so hit the like button if you have understood the concept behind the cerebellum, and don't forget to subscribe to my channel. Thanks a lot for watching this video till the end. See you again next time. Bye bye.